Good morning to all of you. Myself, Professor Basarag, regional.
Good morning, sir.
Vishwavidya Technical University, the regional office and PG Center, Kalburgi. I, on behalf of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Karisiddhappa, Registrar, Professor Deshpande, Registrar Evaluation, Professor Annigeri, all the officials of VTU and staff member VTU Belgavi, and also the chairperson of electronics, Professor Tanuja, the program coordinator, Dr. Shubhangi, and her team, staff members, student of VTU Center for PG Studies, Kalburgi. Welcome all the dignitaries, eminent speakers, and my dear participants. It's really a profound moment for our center to host 5 days faculty development program.
This conference will now be recorded.
On contemporary research trends in electronics, communications, and computer in association of IETE, Institute of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering, Subcenter.
Unmuted.
Before the show begins, I would like to
give
a brief introduction about our university for those participants who are other than Karnataka. My dear friends, Vishveshwara Technical University was established in the year 1998, which is one of the largest technical university in India. And recently it has also ranked 55th rank in engineering in the university category in NIRE. The head office of Vishveshwara Technical University is located in Belgavi. We have 4 regional office and PG centers scattered throughout Karnataka. One is at Belgavi itself, one Bangalore, Mysore, and the host center of the FDP is from Kalburgi. My dear friends, I would like to make you aware that this PG center is located in the backward area of Karnataka, and we are striving hard to reach to the expectations of the university. Many innovations have been done in the field of examination, research and development, and other activities by the university in the past time, and striving hard to do the best in future. I would like to brief about my Center for PG Studies, Kalburgi. It was started in the year 1998, and we have MBA, MCA, and 5 technical programs, namely Computer Science and Engineering, Digital Electronics and Communications, Construction Technology, Highway Technology, VLSI, Thermal, and Machine Design. Let me tell you, friends, the center is providing admissions for the meritorious students, especially from poor background, and we are all facilitating the scholarship, free food, free hostel, distributing laptops and all the resources for the desirable students. Coming to the workshop about FDP, all of you are aware, in the prevailing situation of COVID-19 throughout the world in general and India in particular, we are striving hard to provide free knowledge by conducting several programs online. So this is one of our first FDP being host to provide the necessary research and development activities going in and around. I am really proud to share that the speakers from eminent institutions like IIT, NIT, NIST around India have accepted our invitation, and they will be here with you for the coming 5 days. The only expectation of mine to the participants is we are striving hard to give the best from our side. The workshop is going to be meaningful, the program is going to be meaningful only when my participates with wholeheartedly and interact with the speakers and get the advantage of this program. I once again thank all the eminent speakers who have accepted our invitation and also expect the same in future, such that we can host meaningful programs for our region people, not only in Karnataka but throughout India and abroad also. I once again thank all of you for participating. There is a huge number of crowd right now. We are trying our level best to accommodate the maximum participants over here. The only request to my participants is to participate sincerely in all the sessions and make use of the eminent speakers by interacting. Once again, I thank all of you for participating. I thank my team for working hard. If there are any hiccups, I seek your kind cooperations. Thank you very much.
For me to welcome you once again on the occasion of the Faculty Development Program on Contemporary Research Trends in Electronics and Communication and Computer Science from 6th July to 10th July 2020. The Faculty Development Program provides a platform for the faculty research scholars to have an awareness and updation of the recent research in the field of electronics and communication and computer science and engineering by having an interaction with the eminent speakers. The aim and expected outcome of the program is to explore the scope and feasibility of the present and upcoming technologies. Aim of Faculty Development Program: to enrich the knowledge of the faculties through the interaction with the eminent personalities from the IITs, NITs and NIST and other reputed institutions and industries. The knowledge sharing will improve the teaching learning process and it helps to fill the gap between the industry and the institutions. The total number of participants registered for the FDP is more than 1100, that is 1100 from all over the India. In brief, I will tell you, already the schedule has been shared in the groups which we has been formed in the WhatsApp group. Then also in brief I will tell you, the day wing will be handled Dr. Manu Puram Mahato from National Institute of Technology, Patna, and Dr. Vishwanath K. from SIT, Tumkur, and the topic which they will give the more details on the as a R&D point of view is on the high power microwaves and text extraction from the images. Day 2 will be handled by R&D Dean from Dr. Ajit Kumar Panda from National Institute of Science and Technology, Behrampur, Odisha, on the 5G communication. Day 3 will be handled by Dr. Prashant Kumar Sahu from Indian Institute of Technology, Bhuvaneshwar, and Dr. R. Ravindra from Chandanwala Ramana Engineering College, Tirupati, on optical communication technology, challenges and possibilities, and on image processing. Day 4 will be handled by Dr. Sanjeev Bonde from SGGS Institute of Engineering and Technology, Nanded, Maharashtra, and Dr. Ravi Kumar from Madhila Malviya National Institute of Technology, Jaipur, Rajasthan, on orthogonal transforms, a generalized approach and research trends in visible light and communication. Day 5 will be handled by Dr. Suresh Hallari from MS Bidwe Engineering College, Latur, on research issues in wireless sensors and networks. I hope in next 5 days you will be enriched by contemporary research in electronics and communications and computer science. Thank you one and all.
Thank you. इजी का फास्टी फास्टी का फास्टी इजी का इजी और रे
Good morning all. I am Viresh Pujari, Faculty of Electronics and Communication with you, CPGS Kalaburgi. I being a coordinator, I would like to welcome Dr. Manpuram Mehto. The professor is from, he is basically from Jharkhand and he is an alumni of VTU, SIT Tumkur, and his PG is from IIT Jabalpur and his PhD and postdoctoral from Varanasi, and right now he is at Varanasi. And I would like to request all the participants to please mute your audio device so that it will not create any noise in the middle. So I would like to share the screen to the Professor Manpuram Mehto.
Good morning to all of you. Okay, let me introduce myself. Already they have introduced. Okay, I'm the alumni of Mrs. Kaya Technical University. So I did the BTech BE from there, and then I did my master's at SNTech from IIT Jabalpur, and PhD and postdoctoral from IIT BHU. And currently I'm working as an assistant professor in NIT Patna. So today I'm going to give an overview of the high power microwave sources. So what it is, are what are the different types of high power microwave sources, and what are the research opportunities are there, okay, and why we are looking at the high power microwave sources. So overall, in 1 hour I shall try to cover up the few devices which has been in use for recent few years, okay. And let's start. So at first, everyone's mind comes that what is high power microwave? Electronic from the electronic background. So might be you know that about the vacuum electronic devices. So since very long, we are using these vacuum electronic devices. So before coming to the semiconductor devices, the era was the vacuum electronic devices. So you have heard about the klystron, magnetron, traveling wave tube. So when the semiconductor came into the picture, the vacuum electron devices, the use of the vacuum electron devices degraded very sharply. But in last few decades, what we have seen that a new emergence came to the vacuum electron devices. Because while we are moving towards the high frequency and high power, solid state devices are not that much capable of delivering our requirements. Okay? So high power microwave sources fill gap that cannot be gapped by the semiconductor devices. Because we are talking the power in terms of megawatt or gigawatt. Semiconductor devices can't keep. So vacuum electron devices are still in use. If we talk about the space communication, still we are using the vacuum electron devices. Okay. So while I'm talking about the high power microwave devices, so you can see in the blue diagram. Okay. So so relativistic devices, you can say that relativistic version. I shall let you know that what is the relativistic devices. So that is the relativistic version of the conventional vacuum electron devices like Klystron, magnetron, and TWT. Those are known as that high power microwave. I shall let you know how it becomes microwave, high power microwave. Okay. So basically, we shall focus on particularly three devices which are in use and in our country. A microwave tube research and development center that is in situated in Bangalore, that is a part of DRDO. So that is producing this high power microwave sources. Okay, so another agency is the CD Pilani Samir, and in the research institutes you can name IIT BHU, IIT Roorkee, NIT Patna, and some of the other institutes are also working in this area. And the user agency is also like you can say IPR Gandhinagar. They are frequently using these high power microwave sources. Okay, so what is the high power microwave source? Okay, you can say that its frequency range is approximately 1 to 100 gigahertz, and wavelength is from centimeter to millimeter to millimeter. So this whole cover the 5G band which we are using now. So for the 5G, basically we are trying to use this high power microwave. So its range is microwave to millimeter, and while we talk about the low frequency, its peak power should be 100 megahertz, at least 100 megahertz, and pulse energy is 1 kilo joule. Okay, so that high power microwave can be classified in the two parts. That is, the first is the long pulse duration or high PRF or continuous PRF. So we can say that the pulse length should be in terms of microseconds. But when we are talking about the high peak power, so that will be a very short pulse duration of few nanoseconds, and low PRF or single short pulses. Okay, so this high peak power sources are basically used for the defense applications. They are used to make the directed energy weapons, e-bombs, non-lethal weapons, and long range, long pulse durations. They are used for the 5G communication, material processing, and other biomedical applications. So a lot of applications are there. We can use it for the civilian as well as the military, and it has the it can be used in the radar also, because the 5G is coming to the picture again. We need the source which will be very efficient for the radar system, directed energy weaponry system. DRDO is working on this weaponry system. Okay, so it can used for both hard kill and soft kill. Okay, so just now I talk about its application. One application is e-bomb. So the electronic circuitry. So electronic circuitry can be destroyed, or it can be malfunction using this high power microwave. So I shall give you how it can be. Suppose these electronic devices work on a particular frequency, or you can say that on a particular frequency band it is operating. Okay, so when the use the high power microwave, okay, with the very high power, these high power microwaves, when we launch it into the space, what happens that it interacts with the electronic devices. Okay, and at a particular frequency, when the frequency is matching, okay, so RF is inducing in the electronic devices, and due to that high power, a large amount of current is flowing. Since we are working on in terms of megawatt, or you can say that gigawatt, high amount of current is passing through the electronic circuit, and that current produces a large amount of heat, and that is unable to sustain it, and the electronic component get damaged. Okay, so this is the basic fundamental, and it is also used for the RF acceleration in the high energy linear colliders. So this is used by the IPR Gandhinagar for the fusion and fission reactions, fine detection and clearing, right control and law enforcement. So this right control, basically it is DRDO is making one device that is known as the Gyratron at 94 gigahertz. So that will be used for the non-lethal weapon. Okay, so might we have heard about the pellet guns, which is a destructive method. So this will be a non-destructive method for the right control. What will happen that they will induce RF in the crowd. Okay, and it will induce a large amount of heat on this human skin. Okay, and that can not be controlled, and right can be controlled there. So resonance heating and the current trap of thermonuclear fusion plasma. And apart from this, there are many important futuristic civilian applications of the HPM also. So basically, the vacuum or plasma assisted electron beam devices based on the coherent radiation of the electromagnetic waves, and the RF radiation is generated by stimulus process caused by the electron bunching due to the action of electromagnetic fields. So the basic funda is same as you have known about the klystron and the magnetron. But this HPM devices or high power microwave devices can be classified into two parts. The first is the relativistic devices and another is the gyro devices. So in the relativistic devices, what we are doing that we are using the relativistic voltages. Okay, relativistic voltage that we are using the voltage in terms of 500 kilovolt or greater than that one. And in the gyro devices, the beam is gyrating. Okay, means it is a rounding beam. Okay, so you have seen the spiral binding of your book there. The beams are like spiraling or gyrating. Okay, so this gyro devices are used for the high frequency. HPM sources are magnetically insulated line oscillator and the fast wave devices. So in the fast wave devices, what happens is that the phase of the velocity phase, the phase velocity of the electromagnetic wave becomes the greater than the speed of the light. Okay. That's what we say it is a fast wave devices. And the but I have written that relativistic devices, those are known as the full wave devices, okay, because the phase velocity is less than the speed of the light. So I'm going to cover up this HPM sources, not the fast wave devices. Okay. So one by one, I shall see. Okay. So this is the relativistic klystron. Okay. So might be you have heard from the Liao book that two cavity klystrons operating is similar to that one, but phenomena is completely different. Here the microwave generation is in the relativistic and pillbox cavity along with the propagation of the electron beam at discrete locations. So what happens that we are using the high amount of current, high amount of voltage, so due to which the current is high amount of current is generating and intense amount of RF can be extracted from there. So in the relativistic klystron, the high energy electrons, the relativistic effect change the modulation process compared to the conventional klystron, because due to that high voltage, the electron propagation velocity becomes very high. It is comparable to the speed of light. That's why the bunching becomes very intense there. Okay, and by using a single gap to extract the electron kinetic energy becomes very difficult. And to avoid such problems, multi cavities are needed. Relativistic klystron are widely used as high energy drivers for free electrolysis, directed energy weapons, collators, and so here you are in the diagram, you are seeing that IREB. Okay. That is nothing but the intense relativistic electron beam. Intense relativistic electron beams means the speed of the electron beam is nearly equal to the speed of light. Means when the electron is traveling with the speed of the light, so its bunching becomes very strong, okay, and RF power generated, which is very high there. So the features. So the features of the relativistic klystron is a current of the order of 2 to 10 kiloampere is much higher. By one or two order of magnitude of RK. Electron beam is relativistic with an energy of 300 to 2000 kilo electron volt. Due to the high space charge, potential energy of beam is very high. By using annular electron beam, the space charge limiting current is higher than the solid beam of the same. So the types of the relativistic klystron. Okay. So we can classify in terms of current. Okay. So low current relativistic and the high current relatives. So in the low current, if you are seeing that the current is in terms of ampere, 300 to 7 ampere, and the high current is from 5 kilo ampere to 35 kilo ampere. Okay. And you can see that in the low current, we are using the magnetic field of 3 kc, but in the high current, we are 10 kc. Okay. And in the low current, we are using the solid beam, while in the high current, we are using the anode beam. And fundamental limitations are the microwave breakdown, usually in the output structure, but also in the gaps of the bunching cavity, pulse shortening due to the breakdown and beam loading to the cavity. So the relativistic klystron was the a part of the new version of the klystron. Okay. So that has been used in last decades, but now people are moving to the smarter devices. So another conventional high power microwave was the relativistic magnetron. Okay. So it is the advanced version of the magnetron which we has used in several decades. Okay, but its phenomena is somewhat different from the relativistic magnetron. Okay, so here we can do the direct extrapolation of the conventional cavity magnetron at high voltage, high current, and relativistic voltage but non-relativistic beam interaction deliver large power in terms of a gigawatt pulse power and the megawatt continuous power. Okay. So I talked about the pulse power and the continuous power. The pulse power will be in the few nanoseconds, that's why we are reaching to the gigawatt level. But when we are saying about the continuous power, the pulse range will be in terms of microseconds. Okay. And inherently efficient and simple and low cost, limited electronic tuning, that is bandwidth limited. Limited pulse width and limited pulse repetition frequency. Okay. So this is one diagram of which I have taken from some reference. Okay. So this is similar to the conventional magnetron, but the phenomena is somewhat different there. Okay. So these things I want to go in detail, but I would like to focus on the two. So here you can see that the conventional, it is less than 100 kilovolt, and in the relativistic we are using the voltage in 1 megavolt. Okay. And cathode is thermionic and the secondary emission, and while in the relativistic it is the field emission. I shall let you know what is the field emission there in while go to the dedicated HPM sources. Okay, and power is greater than 1 gigawatt and power is less than 100 megawatt. Okay. Another relativistic HPM is the relativistic backward wave oscillator. Okay, so might we have studied about the backward wave oscillator in the microwave subject. Okay, so that is the advanced version of that relativistic backward wave. The phenomena is same with respect to the but I have taught about the relativistic version. Okay. So the phenomena is same. Okay, so this is we are using the slow wave structure there, beam collector is there. Okay, and the electron beam in which it is passing through, it is reflected back and it is connected to the in the same direction in which the beam is launched. The power is extracted, that what is known as the backward wave oscillator, because the due to the reflector the wave is coming back and the power is extracted. So this is a few of the things. Okay, now I'm talking about the dedicated, or you can say that the specialist HPM devices, high power microwave devices. So three devices came into the picture. First is the virtual cathode. From here onwards I'm going to give you the idea in detail, because three devices, that is the virtual cathode oscillator, magnetically insulated line oscillator, and relutron. Okay, so those are frequently used in the research community and the industry nowadays. Okay, so the first device, which is a virtual cathode oscillator, the construction you can see that, so this is a cathode. Okay, and this is an anode, which is basically a metal grid. Okay. And here you can see a virtual cathode. So cathode is a velvet type cathode on which several micro protrusions are there in terms of 10 to the power 6 centimeter per meter. Okay, so what happens is that when we apply a high voltage on the tip of the micro protrusion means might you have seen your the cloths there. So you have seen that in some part of some part it is drawn and some part it is the up one. So tip is there. Okay, you can show that, you can take the example of the cone, and on the tip of the cone when we apply a voltage there, velvet cathode is like that. So when we apply a voltage, high voltage there on the tip of the micro protrusions, a large amount of current is generated, due to which the resistive heating is occurs, and due to which the heat is becomes so high that the electron are emitting from there, and when a large amount of heat is generated, the electron has burst, and that phenomena is known as the explosive emission. So when this phenomena occurs and when the electron is passing through the anode, so then what happens, that beam current suddenly becomes higher than the beam current becomes greater than the phase charge limiting current. And the electrons are depressed, or you can say that electrons are collected. When the electrons are collected, so negative energy is, negative potential is generated there, and it drawn down. वो क्या होता है कि व्हेन वी सपोज वी टेक द मोमेंटम एंड द मोमेंटम ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रॉन्स विल बिकम नेगेटिव ओके सो ड्यू टू दैट वन वर्चुअल कैथोड इज क्रिएटेड सो वी हैव अ रियल कैथोड एंड वी कैन से दैट द वर्चुअल कैथोड बिकॉज अ लार्ज अमाउंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन बंचेस आर देयर when the electron bunch is created since it is made of the electron it oscillates in its mode mean position so due to which the rf is generated this is this virtual cathode is very efficient device and people are using it for the research purpose if you will see in the google scholar you will find the number of virtual cathode papers okay and it is a nice area of the research okay. So the virtual cathode oscillator consists of a cathode, voltage pulsar, anode coil, RF window imbricator. DC potential is applied at the cathode and electron emitted through the explosive emission process which I explained. Due to this phenomena, a plasma layer is formed on the surface of the cathode. So while I was talking about the microtubules, so the cathode is covered with the plasma there. Okay? And this plasma layer helps in the passes of high current electrons. And these electrons are accelerated towards the anode coil, and the anode coil is transparent in nature and allows the electron to propagate through it. So therefore, the accelerated electrons are injected into the cylindrical drift tube. The mechanism behind the operation of the virtual cathode is that the electron beam can carry the current up to a certain limit, and when this threshold point exceeded, the potential energy of the beam becomes a significant fraction of the kinetic energy of the beam. In this situation, the beam current approaches a critical current known as term that is a space Schwarz limiting current. As a result, the electron beam is unable to propagate towards forward and creates a negative potential well, which is known as the virtual cathode. After the virtual cathode formation, some electrons having sufficient kinetic energy to cross the virtual cathode, while remaining electrons oscillate in between the physical cathode and the virtual cathode, and it leads to the growth of the electromagnetic wave in the virtual cathode. The operating mode of the virtual cathode is TM01, and therefore mode conversion a necessary part of the RF exchange. So there are three mechanisms of the RF extraction in the virtual cathode oscillator. You can say that indicator. The first is the axial, and second is the reflex drive, and another is the coaxial voltmeter. So here the three structures there. The first one is the axial imbricator. You can say that the extraction is axially. Okay. Another is the reflex. Okay. So we are using the reflex method, and another is the coaxial because we are using the coaxial method of extraction there. Okay. So this is the momentum of the electron which indicates the virtual cathode. Here you can see that. Here you can see that electrons are bunched here, which is becoming negative here. You know that the electrons are negatively charged, so a large amount of when the electrons are there, its momentum gets negative. That's why it becomes stationary there, and it's like acts like a virtual cathode. Okay. So this virtual cathode phenomenon in high power microbeam is very important, and it is used to enhance the performance of the device. So this is an axial imbricator with different extraction possibilities. Okay. So first is the extraction from both end of the anode. Okay. And another is extraction from the anode cathode side. Okay. So here is the anode cathode side. And this is the third one is one experimental diagram. Here you can see that metal grids or coils are used, which have shown use the anode. And this part is like the cathode there. So you use some more pics there. Okay, so reflex triode there. So this is an experimental device fabricated. Okay, so this is the anode here, and this is the that is the cathode here. Okay. So radially extracted electron. So in the radially extracted electron, microwave emission is monitored radially around the virtual cathode through four rectangular waveguide opening position such that the electric field vector is parallel to the direction of electric field of the virtual cathode. Okay, so here is the radial extraction of window here, and axially extracted window here. You can see that in the axially extracted imbricator, a long waveguide is used axially with the waveguide terminated in a horn antenna located inside an evacuated anechoic chamber to detect the microwave. Okay, so this I have gone through the virtual cathode, and I would like to have some queries, okay, if someone has, so that I can proceed to the next device. Okay, so the next two devices are very important, okay, and they are being used for. So if someone has query, they can ask about the virtual cathode. Okay, no queries is there, then we can move.
Where exactly this virtual cathode is used?
Actually, this is used for that high power microwave generation. Okay, so this is used for basically directed energy weapon. You can show that what happens that it is attack like a source. Okay, it is generating the RF. Okay, and then it is connected with some external devices like horn antenna, and it is radiated in the air. Okay, and its application is virtual cathode application is in directed energy weapons or e-bomb, you can say that. And particularly now people are using for the biomedical applications for the imaging, because when it is radiating a large amount of RF, that can be used for several applications.
Does this virtual cathode helps in biomedical use side? Any other medical imaging process I can perform using virtual cathode?
Because in some of the Russian scientists are trying to use for the terahertz imaging of this virtual cathode. So they are making the nano variegator. Okay. So they are trying to develop the nano variegator. So the frequency will be in the terahertz. So that can be used in the terahertz imaging.
Okay, but major applications are, according to you, military applications as well as biomedical applications.
Biomedical applications and the imaging section, Russian scientists are trying to develop the nano variegator. So they are trying to develop the terahertz variegator so that that can be used in the terahertz imaging.
And what are the other kind of applications? Like suppose if you are making a it used for military applications as well as in biomedical.
Actually, now people are trying to use for the communication purpose. Now 5G came into the picture, so they are trying to develop for a point to multi-point communication. So point to multi-point communication is that it will be for a big limited range of application. Suppose that it is one application is in Britain. They are trying to use it for that point to multi-point communication for 1 Gbps speed. Okay. So in the air they can 100 Gbps speed. So it will be sent, the RF will be sent from a particular point, and up to 1 kilometer it can provide up to 100 Gbps of speed there.
Okay.
So they are trying to develop the point.
This particular speed will not be useful for any of the like animals or birds, like as we have seen in most of the television movies and cinemas. Like, does this speed will affect them?
No. These are the RF, because on a particular frequency range, if that falls, might that can affect. Because if you launch this RF, okay, to our human body, let us suppose that you launch on a human body. Human body particularly intact at 95 gigahertz, 94 gigahertz range. Okay, so for that one, the people are trying to develop the gyrotron, so that the mob can be destroyed there. Might be you have seen one movie in a Hollywood movie, Hulk. I think you have seen.
Yes. I have seen.
So in one situation, so they came with some vehicle and they are sending some electromagnetic waves. Okay. So those are nothing but the non-lethal weapons. So gyrotron is used for the non-lethal weapons, and they interact with the human body, and they produce a large amount of heat on the human skin there. Okay. And it is so intense that suddenly we have to run away from there. It is like, I mean, it is the replacement of palate glands, you can say that.
Okay. And the any other future implementations in any of the sector apart from these two? According to
the millimeter wave, people are trying to convert these devices so that they can be useful for that 5G application. Because when we talk about the 5G application for 5G communication, so the conventional semiconductor device or solid state devices are not capable of giving that much of power, because these are the high power microwaves. They can be they can provide high much power, but the thing is that the limitations is that when we are going for that high power, the time is very limited there, okay? Because we are using the explosive emission cathode, and that can sustain for a limited time. That is the main disadvantage. So people are trying to overcome that area. If that can be, so these sources will be a perfect use in the 5G communication. Nokia and Siemens has launched one program at 74 gigahertz for the 5G application to use these devices.
Right, sir. Right, right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone have some question, then we can ask, or I shall proceed to the next device.
Sir, hello, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, we can have question and answer session once you are done with your presentation. So it will be good. Any questions?
Okay.
The participants can note down the questions. At last, we will be having 10-minute session only for question and answer. You can raise your questions during that time.
Okay. That's fine.
Continue, sir.
Okay. So another device that is a very popular device, that is the magnetically insulated line oscillator. And I'm glad to say that DRDO has almost developed this magnetically insulated line oscillator. Okay. So this, you can say that advanced version of the magnetron. So you have seen that magnetron, and I talked about the relativistic magnetron, but this is the far better than that relativistic magnetron. Why? Because I shall tell you the reason. Okay. So at first, I shall let you know about the relativistic magnetron. In the relativistic magnetron, we were using the external magnetic field to guide the electron beam. So when we are using the external magnetic field, the device becomes so bulky. But if we somehow, if we eliminate the requirement of the external magnetic field, if we eliminate the external magnetic field requirement, so that will be very compact, and device can be used in several applications. And our answer is the MILO, okay? Because relativistic magnetron and magnetron are already very popular device and used in several applications. In household applications, we have seen microwave oven, so there we are using the magnet. Okay. So, but when we talk about the magnetically insulated line oscillator, again, we won't need any external magnetic field. And the current developed in the device becomes so high that it is self-sufficient to focus the electron beam in the longitudinal direction, and we won't need any external magnetic. Okay. So magnetically insulated line oscillator MILO is a cross-filled high-power microwave source whose operation is similar to the magnetron. It indicates the principle of magnetic insulation flow and slow-wave devices. Okay. So these are the slow-wave devices. Okay. So basic slow-wave devices you have studied in the Liao book, I think so. Okay. And MILO consists of coaxial loaded metal disc working at a slow wave structure, explosive emission cathode. So this is the explosive emission cathode, which is covered with the velvet cathode. The phenomena which I have explained while explaining the virtual cathode oscillator, that is the same with that one. Metal disc acting like a filter come choke cavity. So this is the choke cavity. It helps to stop the beam which is going backward. Okay. And extraction cavity, so this is one extractor there through which we extract, and stubs, and the collector stub is used for the impedance matching so that the impedance can be matched there. Okay. So a high DC potential is applied between the anode and cathode, causes explosive emission and forms the plasma line at the cathode surface. So when the current at the load side, charging current become equal to the critical current, magnetic insulation takes place near the slow wave structure, and the electron beam drift parallel to the cathode surface. Beam wave interaction takes place near the slow wave structure, and when the drift velocity becomes equal to the phase velocity of the RF, and the energy stored in forms of standing wave in the slow wave structure. So here you can see one 3D diagram of the magnetically insulated line oscillator. Okay, so it is basically M-type, or you can say that cross-filled high-power microwave source. Okay. So it is similar to the magnetron slow-wave structure, and it is the relativistic device. We are using the field emission cathode, distributed electron device, non-reinfluent cavities, TM mode of operation, and pi mode of operation. I shall let you know the pi mode of operation. Okay. And self-magnetic insulation and generation. So these are few of the development which has been done in the field of magnetically insulated line oscillator. You can say the MILO. In UK, they have developed L-band 17.5 gigawatt default MILO. Okay. So you can see that power level. Okay. So this is basically used for the business application. And in USA, they have developed the L-band 3 gigawatt of the conventional MILO. And France, S-band 1 gigawatt of the conventional MILO. And in China, they have developed so many MILOs in S, C, and X-band, 3.4 gigawatt, 7, 10 gigawatt, and 2 gigawatt, respectively. Okay. And in Korea, it is L-band 2.1 gigawatt conventional. In Ukraine, Russia are also trying to develop their own magnetically insulated line oscillator. They are in the process to develop the magnetically insulated line oscillator. And in India, that MTRDC, DRDO Bangalore, they are in the process they have already tested the first phase, and might be in recent 1 or 2 years, they will able to generate their own MILO for different applications. So this is one three-dimensional diagram, how it is there. Okay, slow wave structure is there, cathode section is there, extraction is there. And this is one photograph of the compact MILO assembled here. So this is the slow wave structure and all the assemblies here. And another photograph of the MILO, which I have taken from the cousins people. Okay, and this is the cathode. So this is the cathode, that is the stainless steel cathode, over which a Belvin cathode is there. Okay, Belvin cathode that is used for the explosive emission process. And this is the sub-assembly of MILO. Okay, so the voltage, the high voltage which I'm talking about, that they are giving the voltage greater than the 500 kilovolt or so, or you can say that 1 megavolt. So that is provided with the mass generator. So mass generator is nothing but a bank of capacitors. Okay, so they used to charge and they used to give the pulse voltages there. Okay. So the voltage can be in few nanosecond only. And this is the another sub assembly of the mass generator. Okay, of the Seoul National University, South Korea. And this is the another assembly. So they are using it for the 1.2 gigawatt L-band. Okay. Advantages generates the gigawatt of power. Magnetic field is self-generated. Provide a good impedance match to low impedance pulse power sources. Simple, compact, and light wave. Because no external magnetic field or coils. No change in the frequency of oscillation. Even if applied, voltage changes. Handle extremely large power, more than 10 gigawatt at modest applied voltage, and output mode is TM01. So this is the end of the MILO. And disadvantage is that it is, since we are using at the high voltage, the disadvantage is the pulse shortening, energy and efficiency is low because of the coupling with external waveguide duration, the extraction, and the wrong selection of the device parameter, and poor extraction efficiency. Okay. Efficiency is very less in Mercator and the magnetically insulated line oscillator. Okay, so it is less than 15%. So you can say that the efficiency is very less. Okay. So the next device we shall move, which is very recent and which is the futuristic device, you can say that, in the field of high power microwave, and people are trying to develop. So it is very complex device, but its efficiency is quite better than the magnetically insulated line oscillator, MILO, and Mercator. Okay. So it is a relatively new member of the Klystron family. You can say that it is the member of Klystron family, but it differentiates in two ways. The bunching mechanism differs from that in the Klystron, that the electron undergoes twice the velocity modulation in the modulation cavity. The bunch beam is re-accelerated to higher energy to increase the energy withdrawn in the output cavities. I shall show you the diagrams and some simulations also of the electron. Okay, so basically this is the schematic diagram of the electron. Okay, so here this portion is the modulation cavity. Okay, so this comprises of the two cavities. I shall give you the details of that one. Cathode is there. The another section, which is the post acceleration section. This section we have introduced a new one. And the advantage of this one, we are using a rectangular waveguide to extract the power. So the power can be directly extracted in TM01 mode. Okay, so we won't need any external mode converter, neither we won't need any external magnetic field. So the device is very compact, its efficiency is quite very high. So it is an O-type device, it is a slow wave, relativistic device, field emission, explosive emission cathode we are using. EM mode of operation and pi by 2 mode of operation, self magnetic field focusing. So the operation will be the TM motor, while we extract the power, that will be in the T mode by using the rectangular waveguide there. Okay. So attractive features of the Relatron: high energy, highly efficient and compact high power microwave sources. We won't need any external magnetic field, and we won't need any mode converter. Provide very good impedance match to low impedance pulse power systems, and frequency tuning is very easy. I shall let you know how the tuning can be done, and device efficiency reach up to 50%. So while we see the counterpart of the devices, the efficiency of the device is less than 15%, but it is quite high. So people are looking at this device and how that can be integrated with the modern system, because this device is very very compact and the efficiency is also very high. Okay. So I shall let you know the operating principle of the device. Okay. So this is one 2D schematic of the diagram. Here the modulation cavity is there. So while we have seen that the virtual cathode oscillator, we have seen only one anode or grids there. Here we are using the three grids. Okay, this is the main punta here. So here we are using the three grids. So when we are using the grids, I told you that the virtual cathode forms in the virtual cathode oscillator. Okay, so the virtual cathode phenomena takes place this one, and bunching is also done in the two pillbox cavity and post acceleration we are using, and this idlers that is used for the frequency tuning of the device. Okay, and output port is nothing but cavity is nothing but a rectangular waveguide. Okay, so principle can be understood: a high voltage pulsar is used to provide the DC pulse voltage to the field emission emissive cathode to produce very high density electron under the explosive emission condition. The modulation cavity of the device is side coupled cavity, which comprises of two main cavities and a coupling cavity, which coupling is connected to the main cavity. So look at this line. Okay, modulation cavity of the device is a side coupled modulation cavity which comprises of two main cavities and a coupling cavity, in which coupling cavity is connected to the main cavity. Come to this section. Okay, so here what happens that, okay, I shall make it blue. Okay, so here you can see that two cavities are there, this axial cavity. So these two are the axial two cavities, and another, this one is the radial cavity. These two are axially connected, and this cavity is radially mounted on these two cavities. Okay, so this is comprised of basically three cavities, and this is the very important structures used in several devices like RF Linac oscillators and several colliders also. The main cavity are covered by three grids, as I already told you about the grids. Three grids are here, as in case of the Relatron. Okay, placed in the back, middle, and front, which allow the electrons to pass through while confining the RF waves in between. The modulation cavity operates in the TM 01 mode, and radial component of the space charge electric field gets shortened between the metal grids mounted simultaneously, allows the passage of the high current density electrons. Okay, so the self-magnetic field produced focuses the electron beam and eliminates the need of the external magnetic field focus. As I already told you that, so this device does not require any external magnetic field. The magnetic field generated due to the current developed inside the device is self-sufficient to focus the electron beams. The phenomena makes the device compact and lighter in weight. The coupling cavity has two idlers, which makes the reentrant section of the cavity. Okay, so these two idlers. Idlers are there, which is making a reentrant cavity. Okay, so like a reentrant cavity. So, since this modulation cavity is comprises of three pillbox cavity. Okay, so we have the three resonant modes there. Okay, so all of the three resonant modes are based on that electric field patterns there. So they are like zero mode, pi by two mode, and pi mode. So when the electric field in the main cavities are in the same direction, electric phase are along with that coupling cavity, then it is zero mode. And in the pi mode, the electric field in the main cavities are in the same direction, but in the coupling cavity in the opposite direction. And in the pi by two mode, no electric field will be there in the coupling cavity, while in the axial cavity it will oscillate in the opposite polarity. Okay, so our mode of operation will be pi by two mode, because it gives a maximum oscillations to the device, and the frequency will stable in this device there. So three cavity system has three resonant modes that can exist inside the cavity, that is 0, pi by 2 and pi modes as shown in the figure. I already explained this, okay. It can be easily inferred the zero mode condition, the electric field in the main cavity as well as in the coupling cavity are in the same direction. However, in the pi by 2 mode, no electric field exists in the coupling cavity, but in the main cavities, the electric field are in the opposite phase. Whereas the pi mode condition, the electric field present the main cavities are in the same phase, but the electric field in the coupling cavity is in the opposite phase with that of the main cavities. All the three modes get excited in the modulation cavity, but only pi by 2 mode grows because it is unstable and maximum RF energy transferred only through this mode. Therefore, pi by 2 mode is the only mode of operation in this case. A novel concept of an additional post-acceleration reason is introduced in this section. Post-acceleration reason which I have shown you. Okay. So this is the post-acceleration. Okay. So this is the new concept. Let it come. Okay. So this is the post-acceleration section which is introduced on a new section in this device which has not been used in the conventional HPM sources there. So here the electron beam is first accelerated between the anode and the cathode modulation cavity region, and then bunched electron beam traveling from the modulation cavity towards the RF output cavity is further re-accelerated by the applying external DC potential. So this is known as the voltage stepping. So the post-acceleration gap is an arrangement of a stack of the alternating plastic insulator ring and aluminium ring grating which act as a high voltage insulator. It lies in between the modulation cavity and RF expression cavity. So the application of the additional accelerating potential causes the electron bunches to pass through the post-acceleration gap with a uniform velocity approximately equal to the speed of the light. Since all the electron bunches have a constant speed, their relative positions are maintained, which helps in reducing the relative kinetic energy spread and thus also increases the beam energy. Okay. The electron bunches passes through the post-acceleration gap are highly relativistic and power can be extracted from these bunches as they enter the RF cavity section. The extraction cavity is a rectangular waveguide through which power can be extracted in dominant TE1. Okay. So this is one circuit diagram of the modulation cavity. So I told you, this is made of the three cavities. Okay, so this, if I'll see this way, okay, so this is one cavity which is back to back another cavity, and this is the coupling cavity over which, okay, and idler is there below idler, so which is used to shift the frequency there, which is used to shift the frequency. And so this is one of the tuning plungers there, which is used to make the device the frequency tunable. Okay, so another disadvantage of the device is that it can be make frequency tunable. Means frequency can be tuned plus minus 5% to 10% in the mean frequency of the device. Okay, so this is another side of the tuning plunger. So the two way of the tuning plunger, one is the asymmetric way, another is the symmetric way. We can use this tuning can be done. Just a minute, I'm getting some call. Hello. 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 Bolie. Actually, OBC ke liye apply karna hai. अरे सर, मैं भी तो यहाँ पे असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर हूँ सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट में. लास्ट टाइम मैंने अपने नाम पे दिया था बना के, तो उन्होंने बोला नहीं, वो पापा के नाम पे दिया था, क्योंकि रूल में भी बाद में पढ़ा है, तो उसमें जो पापा का इनकम आता है, जो सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट का रूल है, उसमें ओबीसी है, पापा की इनकम पे बनता, कैंडिडेट की इनकम पे नहीं बनता. तो पारिवारिक आय पापा का इनकम होता है. उसमें क्या होता है, अगर आपके पापा जो है बी ग्रेड ऑफिसर नहीं, आपके मम्मी का, तब जाके आपको ओबीसी अप्लाई मिल सकता है. ठीक है, और उसमें भी जो इनकम होता है वो सैलरी से और जो एग्रीकल्चरल इनकम होता है वो काउंट नहीं. ये रूल है सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट में, मैं भी जॉब करता हूँ. ठीक है, मैं मैं असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर में हूँ. ठीक है, यहाँ असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर. हाँ मेरे को जैसे सर सब जगह यही होता है प्रोफेसर। तो वो पापा का इनकम जो कैंडिडेट का होता है वो काउंट नहीं होता है, नहीं तो फिर अगर मैं प्रोफेसर के लिए अप्लाई करूंगा जो भी सीधी वैकेंसी निकलती है एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर के लिए तो फिर कैसे करेंगे बताइए। वो उसमें रूल वही है ठीक है, आप एक बार रूल देख लीजिए ठीक है, एज पर रूल है नहीं ठीक है, आप एक बार देख लीजिए रूल भी जो है देख लीजिए। अब फैमिली इनकम है उसमें कैंडिडेट का इनकम काउंट नहीं होता। हाँ एक बार रूल आप रूल देख लीजिए सर, मैं भी सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट फिल्म sorry, was getting some call from my home. Okay, so we shall continue here. Okay, so we are using the asymmetric tuning plungers and the symmetric tuning plungers there. Okay, for the frequency tuning operations. Okay, so this is one modulation cavity there. Okay, so here you can see that the cut is there, which is used for that. Coupling cavity and metal grids are there, the three grids which I have shown you there. Okay, so this is one experimental device. Okay, so you can see the visualize of the tungsten metal grids here, how they have used the three grids back to back there. And this is the annular cathode from the Relectron Velvet cathode. Okay, so it is the experimental device. Okay. And this is one experimental setup of the Relectron which has been performed in the University of New Mexico. So here you can see that the mass generator is there in the below side, okay, and the Relectron cavity is kept here, which is quite small there. Okay, processor goes there, direction coupler is there to extract the power there. So this is one S-band Relectron tube on operating frequency is 3 GHz, power is 20 megawatt, and pulse duration is 2 micro per second. And this is the one Titan's Titan one company is there in the US which basically develops the first experimental Relectron. So it is in the L band and power is around 200 megawatt and pulse duration is 900 nanosecond. And so I did also that PIC simulation using that is particle in cell simulation of the Relectron using this parameter. So I have chosen the frequency at 2.75 gigahertz, and we have given this values there. These values there. So this is one CAD diagram of the. This is one CAD diagram of the Relectron. Okay. So here you can clearly visualize about the device. Okay. This is the annular cathode which I have shown you, the experimental one. So this is the upper one is the coupling cavity and the modulation cavity, and the three grids there, and the post acceleration cap and drift tube. And the expansion cavity, a rectangular waveguide, and a beam down. So when I gone through the three modes, I did the eigen mode simulation. Okay. So as I already explained you that about the three modes. So this is the phenomena of the three modes there. Okay. And bunching process. So what happens? The electron gets accelerated in the first half cycle and gets decelerated in the second half cycle. Basically, what happens that the transit time of the transit time of the device is splitted in the two half cycles. So in the one half cycle it gets accelerated and another half cycle it decelerated. So due to that acceleration and deacceleration, the bunching becomes very intense. Okay, and bunching becomes very intense, and the velocity the electron velocity spread can be reduced by the application of the post acceleration process there. So this is the phenomena which I have already explained. So the main funda which makes the Relectron very efficient is the virtual cathode formation in the Relectron. So what happens that while we are using the three grids, okay, so there is a possibility of formation of the multiple virtual cathodes. Since we are using a single grid in the virtual cathode oscillator, a single virtual cathode is forming. But when we are using multiple grid, okay, so multiple virtual cathode formation occurs. Okay. So this is three grids are formation. So virtual cathode is one is formed here, second is here, and third is here. And this all is the periodic in nature. Okay, so this is all in the periodic in nature. Okay, so this is all about the my presentation. And further, for few minutes, I would like to show the devices. Okay. If you can see my screen, Yeah, so this device I simulated on CST Studio suit, and this is the device, and I can preferably show you how it is behaving, how the electrons are passing by the electric field. So you can see that electric field lines are there, how it is moving and propagating here. Okay. So this is the contour contour plot, and if I shall show you the magnitude of, let me plot properties. A vector plot. Now I'll animate and show you how the field is moving there. Okay. So in pi by 2 mode, what happens, the electric field lines are becoming opposite in phase in all the in the two axial main cavities of the modulation cavity. Okay. So this is one diagram. The another which I like to show you the magnetron there. Okay, which okay, I shall show you the animation of the field. How it is operating in the pi mode there. You can see that it is going, leaving one gap in between. Okay, so this is the operation of the magnetically insulated line oscillator, which I like to give some idea of the device. Okay. Now it is operating there. Okay, that's all from my side, and 5 minutes, 10 minutes are there, and it is open for the QA answer, question answer session, so that if someone has some doubt, I can clear those doubts. If someone has doubt, they can ask. Shudhir, are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Hello. What is the scope of research in this particular area, sir?
Yeah, that is because high power microwave research is growing in last 3 to 4 years. Okay, and a lot of industries and the academic institution come up together to do the research in this area. And the nice thing is that this is very narrow area where a lot of scope is there. While we talked about the defense sector and the communication in 5G and terahertz communication.
Okay, what is the scope for engineers?
Engineers is that department? you can make this device in collaboration with any of the agency like DRDO or IPL Gandhinagar or CIR Pilani. Because you need some agency to test your device. You can make your device, but testing facilities are very costly, so you can't set up in your institute. Even we don't have. You can fabricate the device. You can test at the nodal agencies there. Okay. And the thing is that they have a lot of project. Okay. A lot of project are done with the. Yeah. Pardon?
We can get good projects on this. Microwave engineering from DRDO as well as ISRO. Can we get
DRDO,
good projects?
ISRO is also using this vacuum electron devices. So a number of projects are available to them.
Okay. And who are the target engineers? Which department engineers can?
Electronics.
Only electronics.
electronics,
computer science engineering.
A lot of scope is there for computer science. Okay, so basically I can say that the electronics engineer will be the more beneficial to this field.
Right. Since I am an research scholar in computer science, so looking out for the some of the good opportunities.
That you can use. Okay, but you have to go to the application side of this. People are now trying to use for that IoT and artificial intelligence. So IoT for different IoT device, you can use that as a source for different antenna.
Any postdoc positions available on this particular area?
Postdoc positions are there in particularly it is related to the defense. When it comes to the defense, the other foreign university, they won't allow us to go to the lab. Okay, but if it is the civilian side, they will particularly allow. Seoul University in South Korea is there, they are offering. And University of New Mexico is there. I mean, Indial Siamlaglu was the pioneer person. They have some postdoctoral positions there.
Fine. Thank you. Thanks.
Okay. Anyone has have doubt? They can ask. Okay, no one has a doubt now. So, okay, if you have any doubt or query, you can mail to my mail ID. My mail is there on my website. Okay, so it is mmahto@nitp.ac.in. You can mail me. Okay, Sudhir, can we
end now? Sir, it would be better if you provide your email ID in a notepad so that the participants can note it down.
Okay.
You can just go to the notepad and type it over there, sir.
Okay. So it is mmahto@nitp.ac.in. Okay, so this is my email ID. If someone has query, okay, they can contact me regarding this. A lot of research opportunities are there, okay, and very good papers are coming in this area nowadays, and people are trying to use the metamaterial based high power microwave source. Okay, so when I shall get the next time to interact with all of you, I shall go the advanced version of these things, because these are the basic things. Okay, so metamaterial based high power microwave sources are the future of the 5G and terahertz communications.
Okay, sir, if there are no questions, we shall proceed with the vote of thanks, shall we?
Okay.
Okay, sir. I would like Viresh Pujari. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
So this is for organizer. Where we get that feedback link and to get the certificate?
Sir, we have one more session. Sir, for the day we have one more session. In between the second session, you are going to get the feedback link as well as attendance.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I would like to invite Viresh Pujari to represent word of thanks.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor Manipuran Mehta. It was very interactive session on high power microwaves, and you have explained about the opportunities, applications, advantages, and as well and the limitations as well, along with some simulation results also. And appreciate Professor Amarnath Hale was asking very very interactive questions to Professor Manipuran Mehta.
after this at 12 noon we have one more session. After this we are at 12 noon we have one more session from Professor Vishwanath Kapinayya. In the middle of the second session we will be filling our attendance and feedback form so that you can share the feedback. After that you will be after that the session will be terminated and the same procedure will be continued for 5 days. After the end of 5 session, after the end of fifth day, there will be one more final feedback form will be provided in order to get the certificates. Okay. Thank you, sir. We will.
Okay, thank you, sir.
We will rejoin at 12 noon, sir.
With the same link.
Okay.
Kindly request all the participants use the same link for joining the second session at 12 o'clock. And I also request, it's a humble request from the organizing team, kindly mute yourself, please. The question and answer session will be conducted for every session at the last 10 minutes. Therefore, I request all the participants to